So in the previous few classes, we were discussing a particle trapped in an infinite potential well in one direction. Okay, basically a particle confined to move along a line. So we call this line a one-dimensional box. Now consider a situation, a particle confined to move on a plane. Okay, there are different experimental techniques in which particles can be confined to move on a metal sheet, okay, a two-dimensional plane. Such experimental situations can we can model as a particle in a two-dimensional box. Basically, a plane is identified as a called as a renamed as a two-dimensional box. So how do we generalize the results of a one-dimensional box to two-dimensional box? So consider the situation is like this. Particle can be, this is let's say x direction, this is y direction. Particle can move anywhere on this plane. Consider that as a metal sheet. So it's an infinite potential well again, but the particle is confined to move on this plane, and on the boundaries of this plane, potential becomes infinitely large. So particle is trapped here. Okay, now how do we approach this problem? What we can do is the general wave function will be a function of both x and y, right? We can write it as a wave function that depends only on x variable and a wave function that depends only on y variable. Capital X is a wave function that depends only on x. Capital Y is a wave function that depends only on y. So this is so we can do this. Take a time independent Schrodinger equation. This satisfies time independent Schrodinger equation. There we can substitute this. So we can again try a variable separable method. We can separate Schrodinger equation into two equations, one that depends only on x and the other that depends only on y. Then the equations that we get, two equations, two time independent Schrodinger equations that we get are quite similar to, each one will be identical to the equations that we obtained in particle in a one-dimensional box. For example, in one-dimensional box, we have obtained equations of this type, or what you are going to get is d square by dx square of x, where x is the x wave function, plus k square x, it depends on small x, is equal to 0. We get an equation like this. Let us call this as kx square. Okay? And similarly, we will get d square by dy square of capital Y, which depends on the variable y, ky square y equal to 0. I'm not showing the details here. This is variable y. I'm not showing the details here, but what we can do is to take the time independent Schrodinger equation and then substitute this variable. Instead of y, substitute this. So in time independent Schrodinger equation, there will be both dou square phi by dou x square plus dou square phi by dou y square. And there you can substitute and we can do this separation of variables. When we do the separation of variables, we get these two types of equations. Okay. So each one is just like the equation in particle in a one-dimensional box. It can have its own solution. When you apply the boundary condition, you can show that this kx is equal to nx pi by l. Okay, its dimension is l of this. Suppose this is a square. Okay, nx pi by l with nx is equal to 1, 2, 3, etc. Just like particle in a one-dimensional box. And here, ky is ny pi by l with ny. The quantum number along the y direction is 1, 2, 3, etc. We have discarded 0 because it's not physically meaningful, and we have also discarded negative values. We know the reason that we have already discussed in one dimensional box. So we get results like this. Then what about the energy? The total energy of this system, it depends on both quantum numbers nx and ny, can be written as nx square plus ny square y square h cross square by 2mi square. This is the energy. Remember, in particle in a one dimensional box, the energy was n square pi square h cross square by 2mi square. We will get similar expressions from here. The energy from here will be nx square pi square h cross square by 2mi square. From here will be ny square pi square h cross square by 2mi square. Total energy will be the sum of the two. So this is it. And where nx and ny are positive integers. Now we know that from particle in a one dimensional box, the ground state energy for particle in a one dimensional box is pi square h cross square by 2mL square, putting n equal to 1 in particle in a one dimensional box. So in the case of two dimensional box, the energy depends on two quantum numbers. This energy we can express in terms of the ground state energy of particle in a one dimensional box like this. Okay, we can write it like this. Now, what is the difference from apart from the expression? So, the expression of wave function is this. What about the actual values of wave functions? We can substitute for. See, the x wave function will be root 2 by L sine n pi by L into x. Instead of n, we have to substitute nx. Similarly, y wave function also will be root 2 by L. Just like each wave function will be separately that corresponds to particle in a one dimensional box. So the total wave function of particle in a two dimensional box will be 2 by L, root 2 by L from the x wave function, root 2 by L from the y wave function. So 2 by L sine nx pi by L into x sine ny pi by L into y. This is the total wave function. So total wave function will be the product of the individual wave functions, whereas total energy will be the sum of the individual energies. That will be the result. An important feature that comes in two-dimensional box as well as three-dimensional box is degeneracy. What is degeneracy? In particle in a one-dimensional box, corresponding to one energy eigenvalue, you have one energy eigenfunction. Okay, for each n, you have one energy value, n square pi square h cross square by 2mi square. So as for each n, you have an energy value e1, e2, e3, etc. For each n, you have an eigenfunction, energy eigenfunction root 2 by L sine n pi by L into x. Corresponding to each an eigenvalue, you have an eigenfunction. That's called non-degenerate case. Corresponding to one eigenvalue, you have only one eigenfunction. Whereas in this case, in two-dimensional box, we will see that this is a feature in three-dimensional box also. Corresponding to a particular energy eigenvalue, you can have two different, maybe more different eigenfunctions. How do we see that? For example, see, suppose nx equal to 2 and ny equal to 1. Okay, then what is the energy? 2 square is 4, 1 square is 1, that is 4 plus 1, 5 even. Right, when nx equal to 2 and ny equal to 1, the wave function is, wave function will be 2 by L sine 2 pi by L into x sine pi by L into y, right? But the same energy can be obtained when you put nx equal to 1 and ny equal to 2. Then also we get 5e1, 1 plus 4, 5e1. But when nx equal to 1 and ny equal to 2, the wave function is different. Eigenfunction is different. Here you have pi by L into x, here you have 2 pi by L into y. So that means corresponding to two different values of energy, energy eigenvalue, you have the same eigenfunction. So if, corresponding to the same energy I have to say the opposite. Corresponding to the same energy eigenvalue 5e1, you have two different eigenfunctions. One corresponding to nx2 and ny1, the other corresponding to nx1 and ny2. They are two different eigenfunctions, but the energy value is the same. Okay, so corresponding to the same eigenvalue, you have two different, two or more, sometimes it can be more also. You will see examples. So if corresponding to one eigenvalue, you have more than one eigenfunction, that is called degeneracy. Okay, in matrices and also in operators, the idea is this. If corresponding to one eigenvalue, the particular operator, a particular operator has more than one eigenfunction, then it's called degeneracy. We say that the eigenvalue is degenerate or the eigenfunctions are degenerate. In this particular example that I have set, nx equal to 2, ny equal to 1. And also nx equal to 1, ny equal to 2. Energy is the same. We say that this energy eigenvalue is two-fold degenerate. Because corresponding to one eigenvalue, you have two eigenfunctions. If corresponding to one eigenvalue, you have three eigenfunctions, we say that three-fold degenerate and so on. Okay, so that is the idea of degeneracy. Degeneracy is the situation where, or phenomenon where, corresponding to one eigenvalue, you have more than one eigenfunctions. What is the operator here? We are talking about energy eigenvalues and energy eigenfunctions. That means we are talking about eigenvalues and eigenfunctions of energy operator, that is Hamiltonian operator. Okay, so here the Hamiltonian operator has degenerate eigenvalues and eigenfunctions. This was not there in one dimension. Okay, in one dimension there is no degeneracy. When you go to higher dimensions, degeneracy will appear. As symmetry increases, degeneracy increases. Okay, so we will see examples of what are the different energy values of two-dimensional box. I will make a table of these energy values and we will see what are degenerate energy values and what are the non-degenerate energy values for two-dimensional box. Okay, so these are the energy eigenvalues of particle in a two-dimensional box. E nx ny is nx square plus ny square times E1, where E1 is the ground state energy of particle in a one-dimensional box, which is pi square h cross square by 2 ml square. And each nx and ny varies like 1, 2, 3, etc. So let us consider different energy values of particle in a one-dimensional box from lowest value upward. So first possibility is nx equal to 1 and ny equal to 1. Okay. So this is I will use this notation E11. Okay, E nx ny, and this is equal to, you put nx equal to 1, ny equal to 1, you get 2E1, right? So 2E1. And here, corresponding to nx equal to 1, ny equal to 1, there is only one possibility. There is only one eigenvalue and correspondingly you have one eigenfunction. So this is non-degenerate. There is no degeneracy. So next possibility is nx equal to 2, ny equal to 1. But when you put nx equal to 2, ny equal to 1, the value is 5e1, right? 4 nx, 2 square is 4, 1 square is 1, 5e1. So we have, here I will use the notation e21. But the same value you will get when you put nx equal to 1 and ny equal to, so 1, 2. This is e12. Okay? Both of them has the same energy value. E21 and E12 has the same energy value. And what is the value here? 5E1. But when nx equal to 2 and ny equal to 1, you get one eigenfunction. Okay, and when nx equal to 1 and ny equal to 2, you get another eigenfunction. So this is two-fold degenerate. Two-fold degenerate. This eigenvalue is two-fold degenerate. So next is both can be 2, that is E22, this is 8E1, and this is non-degenerate. There is only one possibility here to get 8E1. Then we can have 3, 1 and 1, 3 correspond to these two, that is E31 and E13. You have the same energy, 9 plus 1, that is 10E1. Again, you have two-fold degeneracy. Okay. In this way, you can construct different energy values. Okay. It's it's good thing to construct this energy values for, let us say, some 5 or 6 energy values. You have first 4 energy values are there, 2, 5, 8, 10. Then it goes a little bit tricky. Then what is the next one, next higher, etc. You can try out, okay, different possibilities. And I will just write one case where, so this can go on. I will just write one case where there can be threefold degeneracy. Suppose nx equal to 5 and nx ny equal to 5. So we have e55. e55 means 5 square plus 5 square, we have 50e1. Okay. But the same thing can be obtained when nx equal to 7 and ny equal to 1. 7 square is 49, 1 square is 1, so we get again 50. And or nx equal to 1, ny equal to 7. So these three, that is e55, e71, e17, these three states have the same energy, 50 times e1. But nx equal to 5, ny equal to 5, that is one eigenfunction. Nx equal to 7, ny equal to 1, another eigenfunction. Nx equal to 1, ny equal to 7, another eigenfunction. Okay, you substitute the values in the eigenfunction. What is the expression for the eigenfunction? 2 by L sine nx pi by L into x into sine ny pi by L into y. So in that, if you substitute for nx and ny, for each nx ny combination, you get one eigenfunction. So for these three combinations, you get three different eigenfunctions, but the energy value is 50 e1, same. So corresponding to one eigenvalue, you have three eigenfunctions. So this is threefold degeneration. So in between there are many energy states. Okay, you can try to work out maybe some first 10 energy states. This I don't know whether this will come in within the 10 first 10 energy states, but energy values you can construct, and you can see what is the degeneracy in each case. Okay, now we will go on to particle in a three-dimensional box. Surely it also will exhibit degeneracy. Okay, it is instructive to work out the different energy values in three-dimensional box. Okay, here consider a particle confined to move inside a cube. Okay, a cubical space like this. Okay, let us say this is x axis, y axis, z axis, and the dimension is the same. Okay, so the particle is trapped inside this cubical space. And at the boundaries of this cubical region, 0, 12 along the x-axis, 0, 12 along the y-axis, and 0, 12 along the z-axis, at the boundaries, the potential becomes infinitely large. So it's again a particle in an infinite potential well, but it is confined to move, it can move along three dimensions within this cube. This is particle in a three-dimensional box. Finally, this can be considered as a box. Okay, one-dimensional box was a line. Two-dimensional box was a plane, and this is finally a box, three-dimensional box. How do we solve this problem? What we can do is, now the wave function of the particle depends on x, y and z. Now we can try the separation of variables. We can try like this. This is a product of three wave functions. One that depends only on the variable x, the other second that depends only on the variable y, and the third that depends only on the variable z. When you substitute this in time-independent Schrodinger equation, we can separate that Schrodinger equation into three one-dimensional Schrodinger equations. One depending only on x, the other depending only on y, a third depending only on z. I have written down such equations in two-dimensional case. Similarly, you will get three equations, d square by dx square x plus kx square x equal to 0, similarly for y and z. Okay, so what will be the wave function now? So each of this wave function will turn out to be that corresponding to a one-dimensional case. That is, what you get is root 2 by L sine nx pi by L into x, root 2 by L sine ny pi by L into y, and root 2 by L sine n z pi by L into z. So combining them, we get 2 by L whole cube, whole raised to 3 by 2 sine, and similarly for y and z combined. Okay, well, this is the wave function, total wave function. So it depends upon three quantum numbers nx, ny and nz. These quantum numbers nx, ny and nz they each of them vary like a positive integer 1 2 3 etc. We can discard zero and negative values, just as we have argued in the case of one dimensional case. So what is the total energy? It also depends upon nx, ny, nz. See, in each one dimensional equation, the energy value will be something like nx square pi square x plus square by 2 ml square. Similarly for y and z components. So total energy will be the sum of these three, nx square plus ny square plus nz square pi square x cross square by 2 ml square. And 2 ml square. And this pi square h cross square by 2 ml square, this corresponds to ground state energy of a one dimensional particle in a one dimensional box. Okay, so this we can express as nx square plus ny square plus nz square times E1, where E1 is this ground state energy of particle in a one dimensional box. So the total wave function is the product of the wave functions of ordinary differential equations, and the total energy is the sum of the energy eigenvalues. Okay, total wave function is the product of the eigenfunctions in individual cases. Total energy is the sum of energy eigenvalues. That is the way the result comes when you do the separation of variables. So let us write down the different energy values as in the case of two dimensional box. Let us make a table of different energy values and see how much is the degeneracy. Surely there will be degeneracy. There are three quantum numbers here, okay, because it's a three dimensional box. So there are three quantum numbers, so there are different possibilities such that by changing nx, ny and nz, we can have the same eigenvalue, and we can have more than one eigenfunction corresponding to the same eigenvalue. There will be degeneracy, and the degeneracy will be more compared to particle in a two dimensional box. The first possibility is nx, ny, nz are all 1. So we have E1, 1, 1. That is equal to 3E1. This is the ground state energy of particle in a 3 dimensional box. Remember that in the case of 2 dimensional box, the ground state energy was 2E1. We are comparing again, E1 is the ground state energy of particle in a 1 dimensional box. And it's clear that this state is non-degenerate, because there is one possibility here. There is only one eigenvalue corresponding to one set of eigenvalues, nx equal to 1, ny equal to 1, nz equal to 1. Only one eigenvalue, 3e1. We cannot get 3e1 in any other way. So this is non-degenerate. Corresponding to that, you have one eigenfunction. Then the next possibility is 2, 1, 1. But the same energy we can get in 1, 2, 1 and 1, 1, 2. These three possibilities, that is E 211, E121, E112. These three have the same energy. How much is that? 1 is 2, then we get 2 square 4, then 1 plus 1. That is 6E1. These three correspond to 6E1. But you have different combinations of nx, ny and nz. So corresponding to each combination of nx, ny and nz, we have one eigenfunction. Okay, look at the expression for eigenfunction. Total eigenfunction that we have written down. So we have correspond to this particular energy eigenvalue, you have three eigenfunctions. So this state is threefold degenerate. So the first excited state of particle in a three-dimensional box has the energy 6E1, where E1 is the ground state energy of particle in a one-dimensional box, and this state is threefold degenerate. Okay. The next state is 3 possibilities here, that is E221, E212, E122. These three have the same energy. There are 221 means 2 square 4, 2 square 4 and then 1. We have 9E1. This is the next energy state, and again it's also threefold degenerate. Okay. Yes, the next state is 311. E311, 131, 113. These three states have the energy 3 square 9 plus 1 plus 1, that is 11 E1. This is also threefold region, right? Let us consider one more state. Okay. Let us consider two more states. The next one is in energy 222. Okay, that is 4 plus 4 plus 4, 12 E1. And it is clear that it is non-degenerate. Okay. When the three quantum numbers have the same number, same value, then there is no other way we can replicate it. Now the next state is interesting. 3, 2, 1. There are three possibilities here. 3, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. Okay, what is the energy of these three states? 3 square is 9, 2 square is 4 plus 1, 9 plus 4 plus 1, that is 14 E1. But this 14 E1, there are other ways of reproducing it. That is, since there are three different values, we can take different permutations of this one. For example, I am fixing 3 and 2, 1 and 1, 2, and then if I am fixing, okay, next possibility is, maybe I can change this. I am fixing 3 in the NX and 2, 1 and 1, 2, then we can choose 2 here and then 3, 1 and 1, 3. Then I can choose 1 here, 2, 3 and 3, 2. Okay, when you have 3 different numbers, the number of permutations possible is 3 factorial. 3 factorial is 6. So there are 6 permutations here and all these 6 states, that is E321, 312, 231, 213, 123, and 132. Okay, all these 6 states have the same energy, 14 E1, 3 square plus 2 square plus 1, that is 1 square, and 14 E1. So this state is 6-fold degenerate. State. What is this energy state? This is the first and a ground state, first excited, so first state, second state, third, fourth, fifth, sixth. So the sixth energy state is 6-fold degenerate. It's easy to remember. So also you can look at the energy values of different states. These are the different energy values, first 6 energy values and the degeneracy of particle in a 3-dimensional box. We can see that the degeneracy has increased compared to particle in a 2-dimensional box. This is a common feature of quantum systems, that is, as the symmetry is increased. Okay, here the symmetry is increased in the box. The particle can move from 0 to L along the x direction, y direction and z direction. Symmetry has increased, and when symmetry increases, degeneracy also increases. Okay, so there is a gradual increase in degeneracy from the line to the plane to the 3-dimensional box. Now consider a slight modification of the problem of particle in a box. Particle in a finite potential well. Okay, I will draw the potential energy graph like this. Between 0 and L, between x equal to 0 and x equal to L, potential energy is 0. Okay. Now at x equal to L, potential energy increases, but to a finite value u, v is equal to u. So along this region, x greater than or equal to L, potential energy remains as u. And at x equal to 0 also, potential energy increases to a finite value, v is equal to u. for x less than or equal to 0, potential energy remains 0. Maybe we can call this as region 1, region 2 and region 3. And a particle of mass m is moving in this region. This is our problem, particle in a finite potential well. So the height of the potential well is now finite, it's not infinitely large. But we can say that its thickness is infinite, you know, because for x greater than or equal to L, potential energy remains finite, u. And for x less than or equal to 0, potential energy remains u. And here also one more point is that the energy of the particle, total energy of the particle is less than the height of the potential wall. Okay, I can say that here the potential energy V of x is equal to 0 between x 0 and L, and it is equal to u for x less than or equal to 0 and x greater than or equal to L. This is the finite potential well. We are not going to solve this problem completely, but let us try to understand what is the difference in eigenfunctions and eigenvalue between this particle in a finite potential well and particle in an infinite potential well. First of all, look at the eigenfunctions. Since the potential energy is finite in these two regions, there is no reason why the particle cannot exist here and here. There is no reason for that. There is no reason why it cannot be present. Okay, that means remember that why the particle cannot cannot be present in this region and this region for an infinite potential well, because potential energy is infinitely large here in the case of an infinite potential well, here and here. When the particle is present here or here, the its potential energy becomes infinitely large, total energy becomes infinitely large. That's not possible. Okay, that's why we said that particle cannot be present here, or the wave function will be zero here. But here, since the potential energy is finite here and region 1 and region 3, particle can be present in region 1 and region 3. So the point, the major first difference is that the difference in eigenfunctions is that psi 1 is non-zero. Okay, of course psi 2 is non-zero and psi 3 is non-zero. The three wave functions are non-zero. Okay, then in the case of particle infinite potential well, psi 1 and psi 3 was 0. Now if the three wave functions are non-zero, then the second point is that psi 2 does not go to 0 at the boundaries. Does not go to 0 at x equal to 0 and x equal to L. At the boundaries of region 2, psi 2 does not go to 0. Remember, in particle in an infinite potential well, at the boundaries, boundary conditions were that the wave function vanishes at the boundaries. The reason is that here there is no wave function, here also there is no wave function. So to satisfy the continuity, wave function should go to 0 at the boundaries. Here and here the wave functions are non-zero, so the wave function need not go to 0 at the boundaries. Psi 2 need not go to 0 at the boundaries. That is another difference. And the third point is that if psi 2 and psi 3 are non-zero, the probability density of finding the probability of finding the particle here and here are non-zero. It's very small. Actually, we can when we do the problem fully, we can see that psi 2 and psi 3 exponentially decreases on either side. Okay, psi 1 and psi 3. Psi 1 and psi 3. Exponentially decreases. They are not oscillating wave functions, but they exponentially decreases in regions 1 and 3. They exponentially decreases very fast. So even though it's very small, there is the probability of finding the particle in region 1 and region 3 is very small, but still it is non-zero. There is a very small but significant probability of finding the particle in region 1 and region 3. And this is called quantum tunneling. quantum tunneling, or it's also called tunnel effect. Tunnel effect. Because in region 1 and region 3, see, the total energy of the particle is less than potential energy, right? Here, when the particle is in region 2, potential energy is 0. Okay. Total energy of the particle is less than the height of this potential barrier. My point is that. So, in this region, the potential energy is 0. So, total energy has no problem. There is no issue here. Total energy is equal to kinetic energy. But in region 1 and region 3, what happens is, total energy is less than potential energy, see, we can write total energy as potential energy plus kinetic energy, right? But consider region 3, for example. If the particle is here, if we think about it classically, total energy is less than this height of the potential barrier, right? So, total energy is less than potential energy, then in order to satisfy the relation, this kinetic energy has to be negative. In order to maintain total energy less than U, kinetic energy has to be negative. So, in this region and this region, classically thinking, the particle cannot exist. These are classically forbidden regions. But quantum mechanically, there is a non-zero probability of finding the particle here and here. In a quantum system, particle can exist here and here. It has been physically measured, experimentally measured also. So, this is called the way the particle, a quantum particle, can reach classically forbidden region. This is called quantum tunneling or tunnel effect. Okay, so these are the major differences in eigenfunctions between particle in a finite potential well and particle in an infinite potential well. These wave functions are non-zero, therefore there is some very small but significant probability of finding the particle in these two regions. In these classically forbidden regions, that's called quantum tunneling. And regarding wave function 2, psi 2, it does not go to 0 at the boundaries because these are non-zero wave functions. And also these wave functions, psi 1 and psi 3, exponentially decreases. And what about energy eigenvalues? Regarding energy eigenvalues, we can make an analogy here. In comparison between one-dimensional box and three-dimensional box, let us look at the wave function in the ground state. Okay, for particle in an infinite potential well, the wave function in the ground state wave function, that is phi 1, is like this, phi 1 or psi 1. Okay. The ground state wave function is like this. It is maximum at the middle. This is an infinite well, infinite potential well. For finite potential well, if we draw the wave function in the ground state, okay, we have not completely solved this problem. We are making just a comparison of the results. What you see is that the wave function, as I have specified here, the wave function within the region 2 here, within the walls, this does not go to 0 at the boundaries as in here. Okay, the reason here it goes to 0 is the wave function in this region and this region, x less than 0 and x greater than L, that is 0. So, it should go to 0 at the boundaries also to satisfy the continuity of the wave function. But here, the wave function does not go to 0 at the boundaries. So it looks like this. The ground state wave function is like this. This is psi 2, this is region 2, this is region 1 and this is region 3. Psi 1 and psi 3 are non-zero. These wave functions are exponentially decreasing. But still, the wave function is there, some wave function is there. So, the overall wave function, since psi 1 and psi 3 are non-zero at the boundary, psi 2 should also be non-zero at the boundary, where psi 2 does not go to 0 at the boundary. So, this is the comparison of ground state wave function. So, physically what we can see is that, if we look at these waves, the wavelength of the wave, particle wave, inside this region 2 is greater in this finite well. Okay, in the infinite well, this is the, let us consider some lambda by 2, this is the half wavelength, we can say lambda by 2 is equal to L. But here lambda, value, the wavelength here is not equal to lambda by 2. Okay, so that means a longer wavelength can be accommodated within the well. So lambda is greater here compared to this wavelength. This is greater. L is equal to L is not equal to lambda by 2, or its value is greater. I mean, the value of lambda by 2 is greater than L, you can say. It goes beyond this wall. So lambda by 2 is greater than L here. Here lambda by 2 is equal to A. Okay. So the point is that in this case, for finite well, lambda is longer. Wavelength is longer. If wavelength is longer, momentum of the particle is smaller. Right? Because according to de Broglie's equation, P is equal to H by lambda. So momentum is smaller. So which means energy values are smaller. So for each energy state, okay, the energy values of a particle in a finite well, finite potential well, are smaller than the corresponding energy values in infinite potential well. For each state, the energy value is smaller compared to that of infinite potential well. The ground state energy, first excited state energy. The reason is this: a longer wavelength can be accommodated within the well. So lambda is greater, so momentum is less for the particle in finite well. So energy values are less. Okay. So we have made some qualitative statements comparing the eigenfunctions and energy eigenvalues of particle in an infinite well and finite well. Okay. So we are not going into the mathematical details. It is possible to completely analytically solve this finite potential well problem. It's a bit lengthy. We are not going into those details. In anticipation of the results, we have made some remarks about the wave functions and energy values by comparing infinite potential well and finite potential well cases.